The pre-release reviews were generally positive, while the post-release reviews seemed to be a little bit more, shall we say, realistic? This week in review, we're at the Super Secret Affiliate Station in Dallas, Texas, where we had pancakes. You know, Superman isn't the only one having a 75th anniversary this year. Are you ready to go over the rainbow? Again, only this time in 3D. Starting September 20th, Warner Brothers will be re-releasing the timeless classic The Wonderful Wizard of Oz from 1938 in 3D IMAX. But it's only for a week. Now, William Stillman, co-author of a new 75th anniversary companion book, says the 3D conversion is necessary for the movie to remain relevant for future generations. Now, film historian Scott Essman says this is like colorizing black and white films. Just because you can doesn't mean you should. Now, I would tend to agree with Essman. Of course, you could always do a reboot. Have Bob Orsi and Alex Kurtzman write the script for Michael Bay right after he finishes the Ghost Recon movie that he's developing over at Warner Brothers. Bay is developing the adaptation based on the video game Tom Clancy's Ghost Recon. So the core source material is going to be pretty good starting out. But Michael Bay? Really? This is his first project with Warner Brothers. And Jean-Julien Barrenet, the CEO of Ubisoft Motion Pictures, yes, they have their own division, he says Michael Bay is a master of action movies, and he's a perfect fit. Okay. Uwe Boll must have not been available. Have you seen the photos of the new Transformer robots? The cars, anyway. Paramount has been sending these out to the press. The movie's website is not active yet, but you can register for updates. It's at transformersmovie.com. More video game movies. The Tomb Raider reboot has a writer. Buffy the Vampire Slayer alumnus Marty Noxon will write the new version. Now, remember, the video game from Square Enix also got a reboot featuring a younger Lara Croft that came out this past March. So who do you think they'll get to play the new Lara Croft in the movies? Leave us a comment. Tell us what you think. And for more video game news, make sure you check out The Grid, our monthly wrap-up of the latest gamer gossip and stuff. That's out every first Wednesday of the month. Also, right now, we've got a number of articles coming out of E3. That's at scififorme.com, our main site. G.I. Joe 3 is moving forward. Paramount and MGM are negotiating with director John M. Chu to come back for the third installment, since the second one is pretty much an overall improvement over the first one in a number of ways, despite being put on hold for nearly a year. Skydance Productions is also looking at coming back as a finance partner. World War Z was the other movie Paramount pulled for retooling. Now, depending on which story you read, this could mean anything from minor tweaks to completely overhauling most of the film. I think truth is probably somewhere in between those. But they're certainly pulling out all the stops promoting it now. Star Brad Pitt keeps showing up at preview screenings. One day, he hit Atlanta, Philadelphia, Chicago, and Austin, throwing out t-shirts, schmoozing with Harry Knowles. He was also at the Berlin premiere with Angelina. Paramount really wants you to see this movie, I think. I don't know, are you looking forward to seeing World War Z? Are we still wanting our zombie fix? Last episode, we reported that Arnold Schwarzenegger will be back as the Terminator in the fifth installment of the film series. Now we get word via the Wrap, a Paramount Pictures is negotiating for the distribution rights. And Arnold told Empire magazine that not only is he in the movie, but they want him as the Terminator. Meaning, what exactly? He's the bad guy this time again? He's the main Terminator, has to deal with another Terminator? Or could he be playing the Terminator we saw in the first movie, and we have a little motion capture magic? Could this be the story before the story? He says they'll start shooting in January, so they'd better get a director pretty soon. And with all these big budget blockbuster popcorn flicks with no story and lots of spectacle because, you know, explosions, at some point the bottom will fall out. That's the prediction made by Steven Spielberg. He was speaking at the University of Southern California. He says, it's inevitable that these big $250 million mega smash movies are going to flop at some point. causing a massive paradigm shift in Hollywood. George Lucas was there as well. His idea is that eventually movies will be like Broadway shows. They'll run in the theater longer, have a ticket price closer to $25 a pop for the big tentpole films, and a lot of the smaller budget films like Lincoln or Red Tails will end up on cable. Lucas pointed to the huge advertising budgets as one of the factors in the pending meltdown. Now, what do you think? Would you pay $25 to see Iron Man 5? I don't know. Emma Watson is getting back into fantasy, teaming up with Harry Potter producer David Heyman for a movie called Queen of the Tierling, based on the trilogy of books by Erica Johansson. And these books haven't even been released yet. They come out starting in 2014. According to Variety, the story takes place 300 years after an environmental catastrophe, trope, and a malevolent queen has a lot of power, trope. I think we know how it's going to end before it even comes out, right? Now, this is just me. Could we please get a science fiction story that's got a little optimism about our future? Maybe just one? Maybe? This dystopian stuff's bad enough. It's in the news now. And it's not science fiction. In the wake of the news of all the harmless data collection being done by the NSA and other government agencies, Amazon is reporting that sales of George Orwell's 1984 have gone up almost 5,000%. But I'm sure it's just a coincidence, right? Tale told by an idiot full of sound and fury signifying nothing? Yeah, nothing to it. Joss Whedon's Much Ado About Nothing. See what I did there? It's been performing very well. This is the Shakespeare movie that Whedon shot at his house during his two-week vacation between principal photography and post-production on The Avengers. Fan favorites Nathan Fillion, Sean Marr, and Clark Gregg are all part of the cast of very talented performers. It's a modern retelling of Shakespeare shot in black and white. And while he's been promoting this one, Joss Whedon has also been talking about the fact that female superhero movies are way overdue, and why hasn't anyone made one yet? It can't be that hard, he says. For anyone interested, I wrote a piece on how you could successfully do a Wonder Woman movie. I'm still waiting for Warner Brothers to call me. Now, Shakespeare is certainly no stranger to us in genre fandom. We all know he wrote his plays in Klingon first. Now, In Desher presents the Shakespearean version of Star Wars, the original one. I don't know why it took so long for anyone to think of this. It's a perfect fit. All the archetypes are there. And who can't wait to hear C-3PO in iambic pentameter? There are illustrations, and of course everyone's decked out in their Elizabethan finery. Cosplayers are going to have a field day with this. It's available July 2nd from Quirk Books. Now, some rumor patrol. The UK Telegraph is reporting the BBC has made a decision on the 12th Doctor. According to the report, Skyfall supporting cast member Rory Kinnear has been offered the part. Now, this follows Kinnear himself back in April saying that he was being used as a decoy. Wink, wink. That he wasn't even related to the show, didn't watch the show, didn't know anything about the show, but now he's the star of the show? I don't know. It's just a rumor at this point. We can be pretty sure it's not going to be Helen Mirren. Congratulations to the 10th Doctor this week. David Tennant was among those who won a Daytime Emmy. His was for performer in an animated program. This is for his work as a droid in Star Wars The Clone Wars. And some more award news. The EMP Museum in Seattle will be announcing their roster of inductees for the Science Fiction and Fantasy Hall of Fame. And their announcement process is a little unique. Between June 17th and 21st, they'll release a name a day on their Facebook and Twitter pages, as well as their main site. We'll provide links. And the Hall of Fame was founded in 1996. Began in the Center for the Study of Science Fiction at the University of Kansas in our neck of the woods, before moving to its permanent home in Seattle. You can find out more at empmuseum.org. Now here's a cool little something. New chemotherapy super science packs. International advertising agency JWT has as one of its clients Warner Brothers. And another client is the A.C. Camargo Cancer Center in Sao Paulo, Brazil. Put the two together, you get new IV covers for the Children's Ward. Now the young patients are getting superhero serums and secret formulas for their therapy. In addition, the whole Children's Ward has been made over, and there are even some comic books designed specifically to help explain the treatment process to the kids and their families. You can click on the link and see a video about that. But no cloning yet. Although now we know the little twist in Orphan Black is going to be a little harder to pull off, the Supreme Court has ruled that naturally occurring human DNA cannot be patented, isolated strands or not. This opens the door for more genetic research, specialized treatments, etc., etc. Now, what this does is erases two patents filed by Myriad Genetics, based in Utah, in which they claimed ownership of the genes BRCA1 and BRCA2, thus restricting anyone else from doing research into the mutation of these genes, which causes breast cancer or other cancer growth. Now more researchers, doctors, and science specialists can do research without fear of being sued. However, the court did rule that artificial genetic strands can be patented, so maybe the orphan black girls aren't out of the woods yet. And I tell you, if Tatiana Maslany doesn't get an Emmy for her work on that show. This programming note, Sci-Fi for Me contributor Willow Poulsen was recently interviewed by the gang over at the Alchemical Artisans Hour, talking about her work as a published author. We always like to hype our group of meddling kids, so check that out in the link. And finally, we leave you with this. A custom Jessica Rabbit as Dark Phoenix, except for auction over at eBay, asking price $1,500. It's a one-of-a-kind from Vince Vell Customs. He basically got a broken sideshow statue of Jessica Rabbit, decided, why can't she be a cosplayer too? There's a video. You can click the link to watch it. And you can also click the link to subscribe to our channel. You can be among the first to know when we upload new videos here. We have a number of regular shows at Sci-Fi for Me. The Grid, with the latest video game news, that's out every first Wednesday of the month. And Comic Con Carne, all the latest comic book news you can shake a stick at. Prime hits every second and fourth Thursday of the month. The Silver Screen Edition, with our comic book movie news, on the third Thursday of the month. And juicy tidbits, rumors, innuendos about Star Wars, we call it Salacious Crumbs. All right, we're on the social media, Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest. You can link to us there. Just look for Sci-Fi for Me. And, of course, for the latest news, reviews, interviews, TV show recaps, you can go to our main site, scififorme.com. And that is the Week in Review.